Hello. The topic I would like to speak on today is about the Supreme Court's recent verdict on the Sabarimala temple, temple and temple traditions, and the outcome of that verdict. But before I begin, perhaps in recent times, one of the greatest visuals that we have seen in the aftermath of the Sabarimala Supreme Court verdict, as well as the protests, spontaneous protests that followed. The most enduring visual is that gentleman who is carrying his irumudi on his head and doing the Sabarimala Yatra, and he is literally crying and begging, and he is pleading to the Supreme Court, to the entire nation, to all our lawmakers, to the general public, asking them, please do not destroy these traditions. They have not harmed anybody. What wrong have we done that we have to suffer this? If this does not move the hearts of people, we don't know what else can move the heart of people, and to what further extent that sacred Hindu traditions will be destroyed. So very quickly I will sum up what the whole thing is about. As everybody knows, the recent Supreme Court verdict, the learned lordships gave a judgment which appears straight to be from a feminist textbook, which basically made out the Sabarimala temple entry issue for menstruating women, that is women within the age above 10 years and 50 years, permission to visit the temple. So this is what started off all the protests. Now, of all the, there are about 25 lakh temples, Hindu temples in India. Of all these 25 lakh temples, why was Sabarimala only targeted? And the most important thing to understand is that this verdict is actually the result of at least one decade plus long activism by a select group of highly motivated people, leftist activists, feminist activists, who were hell-bent on, if I would dare to use the word, capturing and destroying the traditions of Sabarimala temple on the flimsy grounds of what they call gender equality. Now, the tradition of Sabarimala is truly timeless, like that of, say, Tirupati or Srishailam or Dharmasthala or any of these, you know, top or most sacred pilgrimage spots for Hindus. Now, what is the benefit of tradition or achara, parampara, sampradaya? The main benefit of achara, sampradaya or tradition is that it preserves and retains the continuity of Sanatana Dharma or Hinduism as a whole and in parts. So the moment, you know, a judgment or anything like that comes to cut off one thread of the tradition, the entire thing is broken. It is like a on a garment, a thread is sticking out and you start pulling it out, neither the thread will remain nor the garment will remain. So this is, you apply this reasoning to breaking off and cutting off the traditions of Sanatana Dharma. So this is the danger that Hindus are faced with, not just in case of Sabarimala. Tomorrow they will come for Tirupati as well. Now, the irony or the tragedy itself, and even the cruelty, I would say, in this case is that this is a temple that was running beautifully, that continues to run beautifully, barring this thing. Those who didn't build the temple, those who didn't maintain it, those who don't have any faith in Swami Ayyappa, those who don't preserve it, those who have no faith in Swami Ayyappa, these are the people who have sat in the comfort of an AC room and they have pronounced a judgment on a temple, on traditions that they absolutely have no faith in. It might be legal, it might be constitutional, this is with due respect to the Supreme Court, but one needs to question what I would call on humanitarian and even the grounds of normal human feeling with regard to spirituality, sacred traditions. On the side of the protests, the communist government in Kerala, headed by Mr. Pinarayi Vijayan, they eventually backed away, looking at the spontaneous upsurge of the protests, and a lot of Hindus claim that it was a victory. But I would respectfully beg to disagree. It is not victory. On the contrary, the fact that so many millions had to come out, you know, across India and protest against the Supreme Court verdict against Sabarimala, the fact that such numbers of Hindus had to turn up on the ground, yes, it shows that the Hindu spirit is still strong, but it also shows that all it takes is just one verdict to expose exactly how vulnerable Hindus as a community, Hindu traditions have become. Now, needless to say, the strength of Hinduism, what made it preserve so far, has been its innate emphasis on the value that it places on what is known as Grihastashrama Dharma. To put it, to translate it loosely, it is called the system of family values, which in turn breeds and fosters what is called a sense of samaj or community. Now, this verdict of Sabarimala has precisely aimed at chopping those things away for good. Now, in many smaller instances, for example, in Karnataka and in large parts of Tamil Nadu and Andhra Pradesh, for example, the temple lands in Godavari belt that under the chief ministership of Y.S. Rajshekhar Reddy were auctioned off. So that once again, while that exposed the vulnerability of Hindu lands, Hindu institutions, properties, wealth, what you call hereditary inheritances of the community, while that showed in a smaller scale, Sabarimala has shown it in a larger scale. So in closing, what I would like to say is that let Hindus take this upsurge as a you know, kind of a wake-up call, which they have already done. But look at the fallout. The fact that I said it is not a victory is that already, even as I'm speaking, the communist government in Kerala has cracked down on the protesters, and according to other news reports, it has appointed CPM party workers on the Devaswam board as, you know, temporary workers to oversee the various rituals so that they can keep a closer watch on what is happening. So this is invasion into Sabarimala traditions and the temple worship culture and everything associated with it. This is invasion by stealth. So this is perhaps the last chance. If we let go of Sabarimala, there is no telling what they will do. Already there have been efforts to plant crosses and open churches in the sacred seven hills, Tirumala, at Tirumala and Tirupati. There has been an Islamic university which I think has already been set up. So this is a kind of with Jallikattu, for example, and with the Supreme Court verdict on Sabarimala, now the verdict has already been delivered. That is an important thing to note, and not the protests, which means a precedent has already been set. What happens in the future happens, but this verdict by itself is a precedent, and this means that all the people who have lobbied against Sabarimala have tasted blood. In their eyes, to their minds, it's a great victory, and unless Hindus come together and take this forward in a bigger way, organize themselves even on a global scale, and make sure that they provide ironclad community-based solutions, there is no guarantee that this will not repeat. On the contrary, it will repeat, because what these guys are doing are leftist and other anti-Hindu ideologues. They have encircled, and they, over the last 4 years, they have perfected the art of starting a new trouble, fomenting a new riot or a new disturbance, or stone throwing or arson, whatever, on a daily basis, which has emboldened them. So they are saying, fine, we may not have political power, but we can still do this. So in my closing message would be to take this Sabarimala protest forward in a spirit of unity and to be undaunted, because like the saying goes, the timeless proverb goes, dharmo rakshate rakshitaha. Thank you.